getting ready for some more baseball in the Canal District. Game five in the span of, by the time this one ends, Mike, it'll be about five games these teams have played in about 52 to 53 hours. Talk about getting well acclimated with one another. If these Scranton and Worcester rosters were not already, they certainly are after another twin bill here tonight.
Yeah, and even the last time that they played each other in July, you talked about the same thing where they played a lot of doubleheaders. So a lot of baseball, they get to know a lot of the same pitchers. And the Woo Sox looking for a doubleheader sweep. They need that. The way they've been struggling here as of late, they came in losing seven of their last eight.
And they got great pitching earlier tonight. It started with Daniel Gossett coming off of the injured list to make his first appearance in 6 weeks. Then in two innings, getting his feet wet, he looked terrific.
Yeah, you brought up the point. He threw everything right away, all four pitches right away. But really the biggest thing for me in this game one, Steven Gonzalez had two runners on with one out in the fifth inning. This really could have flipped the game, but he struck out Greg Allen and Chris Gittens. You see Ryan Brazier there made a rehab outing, had a perfect third inning, was really good. But this is that curveball that we saw a lot of. Gonzalez threw that hook a lot, but he worked in and out of traffic. He did give up three runs over the three innings, but struck out six, only had two walks. Certainly could have been a lot worse. And then in that seventh inning, Caleb Ort getting Chris Gittens the hit into a double play to end the ball game.
And it'll be a bullpen game here in the nightcap for Worcester, starting with the sidearm righty Seth Blair. The lineup that he'll face has Jonathan Davis in the top spot. There's Davis, who had recently been claimed off of waivers by the Yankees. This will be his first ever game with Scranton. He just got optioned back to the minor leagues. Socrates Burrito, there you see him. He will bat at the two spot. Had a good game earlier today. Ryan Lamar's first appearance of the series. The veteran hits third. Armando Alvarez slides into the cleanup spot. Then it's Matt Pita, who's hit a couple of homers this season against Worcester. Max McDowell, a UConn product, does the catching. Kyle Holder, Max Burtz, and Brandon Wagner round out the nine for manager Doug Davis. And for the first inning, at least, it'll be Seth Blair, who is a very interesting story. Guy that was out of baseball for 4 years after the Cardinals, all the way back in 2011, Mike, made him a first-round pick.
Yeah, and we saw him a lot at the alternate site. He was making YouTube videos inviting people and players out of the game to work out at his home. And you see the numbers. Blair has begun the year with Worcester, gone to Portland back, and 2-0 here with the Woo Sox in 12 games with a 3.95 ERA. One thing that we noticed about him last year, his ability to throw hard with that fastball at different arm slots, which is not easy to do.
This will be his first start as a member of the Red Sox organization. The defense behind Blair in this one has Franchi Cordero in left, again Jack Lopez in center. He's been the everyday center fielder here this week. Joey Meneses in right field, so the outfield alignment the same as in game one for Billy McMillan, but the infield looks a lot different. Chad De La Guerra starts for the first time in over a week. He's at the hot corner. Jeter Downs, Jeremy Rivera's moved to second. Christian Arroyo, as we expected, will not play both ends of the doubleheader on a rehab assignment. Josh Ockme over at first. And Johnny Pareda gets the start behind the plate with Connor Wong serving as the designated hitter. Getting ready to go. The first game ended right at 7 o'clock, so it's been 40 minutes between these two seven-inning affairs. Glad you could be with us on Nessa Plus. Blair against Jonathan Davis. And away we go. Almost hit him. Long-time Toronto Blue Jay farmhand and big leaguer. In fact, played 4 years in the big leagues on and off with Toronto before the Yankees just claimed him off of waivers. And he is it. Seth Blair does that. He will pitch inside. He has now hit seven batters in 13 AAA innings pitched.
Almost hit him with the first pitch. Now you put on a guy with blazing speed. Davis made a great catch for the Yankees a few nights ago. That one slips. It's getting the field a breaking ball early.
And that brings up Socrates Burrito. And you figure that Jonathan Davis may very well at some point try to steal second base, as you alluded to. He's a terrific base stealer. And there he goes on the very first pitch. That was like a pitch out, but Pareda made a poor throw. So a hit batter, and then one pitch later, Davis gets himself into scoring position.
Yeah, not surprising at all. I think the saving grace there that Davis didn't advance is because Pareda had so much velocity behind this throw. This was an easy steal, high throw, but it got to the outfield quick. That's why Davis could not advance.
So an immediate chance to strike for Scranton. These teams are playing their fourth doubleheader in this park this season against one another, and they've split each of the first three. There's a good slider for a strike. The first one in the strike zone for Blair. So you figure if form holds, Scranton's going to win tonight. Worcester trying to buck that trend.
They certainly are.
The last time Seth Blair started a game, it was when he was in A ball with the Padres 2 years ago. Another good slide piece, 1-2.
That came up as a starter. Right on the back door. Good pitch there by Blair.
Seth, 32 years of age. One of the guys you really root for because of all that he's had to go through to get to this point in this game. And Brito loops a base hit. Davis will score, and the RailRiders have a 1-0 lead. Socrates Brito gets his third hit in the doubleheader. He's had a good day. And that did not take very long at all, although it appeared to be a pretty good pitch that Blair made. Just give Brito credit.
Yeah, Brito got a pitch there up. And look how easily Davis scored. Davis almost hit his coach rounding third. He was took such a wide turn.
And that instant replay is presented by Manny's Appliances, the official appliance retailer of the Worcester Red Sox. It's about the quickest you'll ever see a team score a run without hitting a leadoff homer. And here comes Ryan Lamar for his first at bat of the series. And Blair not only having a little bit of a command issue throwing to batters, same deal throwing to the bases.
Oh,
my
hit,
goodness.
Yeah, hit Brito in the helmet.
Boy, that really could have been a problem had he not been hit in the helmet.
That's why they have that bill.
And now he's off and running, and Parada throws from his knees. It's close, but late. Well, they've got a book on Seth Blair, and it's run, run, and run early, and they have swiped second base on the first pitch of the next batter each time.
Yeah, great jump. We've seen this against Blair in the past. Might have been a hit and run because he looked back.
That was a great throw from a seated position by Johnny Parada. Lamar has the count even 1-1. Ryan Lamar did not play in any of the first three games here. We don't know why. Although there are a lot of position players currently active for Scranton manager Doug Davis. Been an interesting few months for Lamar. Back and forth for the big leagues a couple of times. Popped him up into second baseman Jeremy Rivera. There's the first out of the ballgame.
Josh, on August 10th, Syracuse stole four bases in the eighth against Blair.
And they've swiped two here in the opening inning. Cleaning up batter is Armando Alvarez. It's been since the last doubleheader that we saw Seth Blair pitch in a game, last Friday against Syracuse. First of these three doubleheaders in a week, I should say. There goes the runner for third, and he'll steal it without a problem. There's Socrates Brito going again on the first pitch. So the last three batters, the first pitch that Blair has thrown has resulted in a stolen base.
Yeah, look, he looks in, and that's it. They've got the book on him. As soon as he looked in, they knew. This is what you want to do as a road team in a doubleheader game.
Now with the infield in, Alvarez takes strike two. If you think about it, the hit by pitch, that was certainly one that Blair would like to have back. Other than that, he's made some really good pitches. Brito hit a soft single, and he got a pop out. But Scranton on the door of getting a couple of runs against him. Big strikeout, though. Goes to the slider to put away Alvarez. Two gone.
Yeah, that's a tough pitch to hit for a right-handed hitter. That's what Blair wants to do. He probably would even like to have it down more in the zone, but this will work. Tons of movement.
Everybody can back up to regular depth on the infield as Matt Pita comes to the plate for the first time today. He's the designated hitter, the VMI product. He's had a couple of homers in this park this year. spent much of the season at AA where he didn't hit a home run at all. But you can see he's hit five of them. That's in only 12 AAA games played. So he's found his power stroke since he's gotten up to the highest level of the minor leagues. Ooh. To the backstop, and so on a wild pitch, Scranton scores. Boy, that's really going to bother Blair because he was one pitch away from getting out of the inning with just the one run, but let that one get away to make it 2-0 Scranton.
And a wild inning. Hit batter, three steals, and a wild pitch. Just missed location here. You see it slips out of his hand. And Brito scores easily.
Well, the Blue Sox trying to stay within shouting distance in this seven-inning game. It's Sean Boyle who's going to start for Scranton. And frankly, you don't know what you're going to get out of Boyle, who just recently jumped up from high A. He went around, says home plate umpire Cody Oakes. 1-2 on Pita. But an inauspicious beginning for Blair and Worcester. Only one ball has been hit out of the infield.
A lot of sliders by Blair.
This may very well be the only inning that he pitches in what'll be a bullpen game here for Worcester. And he got the chase on that slider. Puts away Pita. And so that will do things here for Blair in the top of the first inning. Back-to-back punchouts ended. Three steals, a hit batter, and a wild pitch. And as Sean Boyle goes to work for his first AAA start, he's got a two-run lead. Sean Boyle, 24-year-old Dallas Baptist product. Coming onto the hill for the first inning for the first time as a AAA ball player. He's got a two-run lead with which to work. And the lineup that WooSox manager Billy McMillan has put together to face him has a very different look than we've become accustomed to seeing. At the top of it, there's Jack Lopez. He's leading off. Then it's Chad De La Guerra, who had not played in over a week. He is going to bat second for the first time all year. Franchi Cordero in his first day since coming back from the big league club. He'll bat third again. Joey Meneses cleans up. He has been a prolific run producer since coming up from Portland. Connor Wong has had a great week. He'll bat fifth as the DH. Jeter Downs in the sixth spot. That's been customary for him of late. Josh Ockamy has had a good week as well. He continues to swing a good power bat. Johnny Pareda, Jeremy Rivera round out the nine. All of them to face the 24-year-old, former 25th round pick. Here goes Sean Boyle. Tell you what, Mike, for a guy who never pitched in AA, Sean Boyle has had two terrific relief outings to start his AAA tenure.
Eight strikeouts and eight and a third in AAA. He began at low A, Josh, low A Tampa. Then high Hudson Valley, and now with the highest level of the minors.
He did pitch one of those first relief appearances with Scranton against Worcester, and it was a gem back on the 7th of the month. And he makes very quick work of Jack Lopez, who is now 1 out of 14 in the series.
That's a signature pitch, that slider. All right, Scranton there. Defense lines up like this. Lamar, a lot of big league guys. Davis in center, Brito in right. Massachusetts native Bird at third. Holder at short. Alvarez playing second. Brandon Wagner at first. And Max McDowell catches Boyle.
Boyle on the 7th of the month pitched four scoreless innings against Worcester. That was his AAA debut. He misses outside here to Chad De La Guerra. That was the day that Chris Sale started for Worcester in Scranton. Boyle kind of quietly had a terrific outing. That's called a strike, 1-1. The last time that De La Guerra started a game, you have to go back a week ago Tuesday. Not in the starting lineup the previous eight games. is 1-2 for Boyle. He looks confident in attacking the strike zone with that breaking ball.
Yeah, that's a pitch that he's worked on. He used to throw more of a gyro slider, but revamped his grip. Interesting delivery.
And he starts it off with a couple of strikeouts. This AAA thing is easy, he's thinking.
Well, he's backing up the fastball with all those sliders, so 87 looks a lot harder to De La Guerra. Just late on that.
Boyle has now thrown a total of 9 AAA innings and permitted just one run. That came against Lehigh Valley in a long relief appearance last Thursday, a week ago. 4 1/3 innings against the Iron Pigs, and again 4 scoreless innings against Worcester. And ball one to Franchi. Cordero, in his return to the Woo Sox, went 0-for-2 with a walk earlier in that 5-3 Worcester win. It had a big swing, but it's 1-1. More than I've ever seen, and I've been covering AAA baseball for 8 years now. This season in this league, we have seen guys come up from A-ball and have success pitching at AAA, and I can't really put my finger on why it could be happening, but we've seen it a lot.
Yeah, I don't know if the pandemic has anything to do with it, but you would think they probably wouldn't have started at A-ball then, right?
I mean, some of it is just because of travel issues, and it's easier sometimes to get a player from a certain team up to AAA if they're closer by the A-ball team than the AA. The Boyle's up here out of necessity for the Yankees, but he's pitching so well they might just keep him.
Yeah, the opportunities that certain players have gotten this year, I mean, some of it's been due to COVID. They get moved up and they perform well and they stick.
See if he can strike out the side in order to begin the outing. That's a good take there by Cordero.
Certainly was. Good pitch by Boyle. Sure, he did not see many hitters like Franchi Cordero down in Hudson Valley.
Turned into a gorgeous Thursday night. The count is full, 3-2. When we began the twin build just after 4:30, it was raining a little bit. Of course, we had the torrid torrential downpours throughout Massachusetts earlier today. The skies are clear. The sun has set. We play with temperatures in the mid-70s. Ball four misses inside. Good comeback there for Franchi Cordero. He had fallen behind in the count. And the Woo Sox get their first base runner against Boyle.
Well, I think that's one thing. Learning on the job for Boyle. And A-ball, I'm sure he got a lot of chases in at a bat similar to this. Cordero just took 3 in a row. Did not give in.
I would imagine there's a little bit of disappointment for Franchi not to have stuck in the major leagues for good this time. Back up there for about a month. But every time that we've seen him put on a Woo Sox uniform, he's always had a strong attitude with a smile on his face.
Good teammate. Seems to have fun in that dugout in between innings.
Then now Joey Meneses. Nothing in one, the count. Cleanup batter each end of the doubleheader. Meneses had a big RBI double earlier tonight. In a 5-3 win, he provided a late insurance run with that. 14 games in a row he's started since coming up from AA. On the ground to third. Play here, Max Burks goes the short route to end the inning. A good start for Boyle. A walk and one man left. We've played an inning. And it's 2-0 the visitors in front. We're going to have the great Keith Folk join us in the booth. You'll want to keep it right here and hear from Folky when we come back. 2-0 lead for Scranton after an inning. Game two of tonight's doubleheader here at Polar Park. As promised, we've got a very special guest here in our Nesson Plus booth. A man who in these parts needs no introduction. Hello, Keith Folk. Welcome.
Hello. Thanks for having me. Beautiful night. Happy to be here.
We're always excited to see you. And I imagine that when you come back into these parts, there are a lot of other people who are excited to see you also, right?
It is. It's one of those things where, you know, I've been in seclusion all summer long, and it's nice to come back here where people know who you are. Good to talk to the fans and, you know, hear stories from the old days and stuff. So, and beautiful ballpark. I mean, I'm happy as could be to be here.
It's your first trip, right?
First trip to the new Polar Park, and wow, you know.
We put you to work tonight.
Yeah.
Max McDowell against Seth Blair does get a second inning. Blair spins in the slider for a strike one. Yeah, we saw you a lot in Pawtucket over the last few seasons that we had there, and you would come into town and work with the pitchers. I loved watching you out in the bullpen during those games.
You know, I really enjoyed the mentoring, the advisory part of the, you know, the job. And unfortunately, they, you know, they're moving on. They didn't renew my contract this year, but, you know, I enjoyed it. Love seeing the guys that, you know, I still know, and love being around the game.
McDowell, a UConn product. Seth Blair gave up a couple of runs in the first inning. Trying to settle in here in this bullpen start. 2-1 the count. So when you see this ballpark for the first time, and you compare it to what you had become accustomed to even in Pawtucket, but other stops that you've seen throughout the minor leagues, what are your impressions of this one compared to others?
Well, I mean, in first rate, you know, Mr. Lucchino did a great job, and the staff, you know, whoever designed his ballpark did a great job. But this is what minor league baseball looks like in the new generation. All the southern ballparks all look like this. You know, it's a beautiful place to go. You know, we love Pawtucket. You know, great heritage there, but you know, it got old, and you know, it's good, great for Worcester to have this situation. And then, you know, now they're caught up with the 21st century of baseball.
Well, Keith, I think it shows how healthy the game is, because we're seeing ballparks like this being built in the minor leagues north of $100 million.
Yeah.
It shows you that there's a need for that.
Absolutely. It's, you know, it's a business. You know, not everybody can get to a big league city. So the fact that the Red Sox Nation holds the kind of power that it does around New England, it's beautiful that they were able to build a ballpark here finally. And, you know, it'll be one of those things that is enjoyed by New Englanders, you know, for many, many years.
Well, that's the second inning in a row that the leadoff batter has been hit by a pitch. And so McDowell is aboard. The first pitch to the next batter in the first inning, every time that there was runner on first, they stole the first pitch. So obviously Seth Blair well aware of that. And you got Kyle Holder in the box as we visit with Keith Falk here. See if he runs on the first pitch again. Not this time.
It's pretty short lead there. Looks like he just doesn't look like he wants to go anywhere.
We will stereotype him. He's a catcher. He can't run, right? So how many people come up to you and they do the play-by-play? Back to Falk. How many people?
All many.
Yeah.
Never gets old.
Yeah. I guess I just did it.
Yeah. Well, it was great because, you know, Joe's here, so it's great seeing him. And, you know, I have the bottle opener that, you know, he has good recording on. So it's great to hear that every once in a while and just remind you, you know, it just, you know, kind of keeps you alive,
so
keeps
you
young.
You say it never gets old. I'm fascinated by that, because me just maybe being a curmudgeon here would think, at some point you'd get tired of hearing people talk about the same thing over and over again. But you don't, huh?
No, absolutely not. You know, I played for almost 12 years. I'm only remembered for one thing, you know, but I've become accustomed to that, and I accept it. You know, that what we did, you know, that team was a very special group.
Sure.
And a very, very special moment. And we were able to accomplish something that had been very hard for, you know, for teams before us. And, you know, but that's one thing Red Sox Nation is, the players, current and old. I mean, we all bond together. We see each other all the time at the field. And, you know, it's something they're proud of what we were able to accomplish.
86 years of heartache.
That's a generation that, you know, didn't get what they wanted.
2-2 on Holder. Foul tip held onto by Pareda. Good pitch. That's the third strikeout for Blair. One gone here in the second inning. Well, earlier between games of the doubleheader, we had you out on the field in a spot that you're very familiar with, the pitcher's mound.
No video.
Oh, yeah. Change it was.
That's how I'm going to throw a cutter.
You looked good. We're not going to show you the result of the pitch.
Yeah. Well, it's Tanner Houck. It's the future of the Red Sox. So I'm thinking, just don't bounce this.
It's nice he caught that for you.
Yeah, Tanner and I are buddies, so it's great to see him, and it's great to see his progression into the, you know, into the transition into the big leagues. And great mind, great head on his shoulders, and when he gets a chance, he's going to make an impact for this ball club for a long time.
Max Burt with one on and one out. He's a Boston guy from North Andover and a Northeastern Husky collegiately. Max Burt played for Mike Glavin, the Huskies.
Former minor leaguer.
He's got a pretty famous brother, too.
Yeah, I haven't heard of him.
Good hockey guys.
Great hockey program there. Go Dogs.
That's going to be another wild pitch as that gets off the glove of Pareda. So into scoring position advances McDowell. They didn't have to steal the base. And with one out, it's 2-1 the count on Max Burt. When you're out and about in Boston, let's say you go to dinner. People come up to you. They stop you at a table and say, hey, that's Keith Falk. He's the World Series hero, Keith Falk. Is that a common occurrence?
Common? Absolutely not. You know, maybe 10%. It's one of those things. I'm a 5'11 white guy. It's like I blend in very well in Boston. And, you know, it's one of those things. It takes a pretty sharp eye to recognize me. But, you know, when fans do reach out to me, I make it a point to, you know, spend some time with them and, you know, thank them for their support.
I bet in this era, everybody's on their phone so much, they don't even realize.
Yeah.
You could be sitting next to someone the whole time and they're on their phone.
That's Mike. He's buried in his phone.
Is he? He wasn't paying attention right
there.
That's
right. He didn't even know we were coming back on camera.
It's a prop.
Come on, we got Keith Falk in the booth with us.
No, I know. It's a prop.
Just having some fun here tonight. Now, when you take a look at the state of pitching these days, I think the biggest topic is substance checks. When you watch a pitcher walk off the mound and have to take off his cap and undo his belt and have to go over to the umpires before he gets into the dugout, what goes through your head as a guy who would have had to go through the substance check?
Yeah, it feels like you're back to being 10 years old and you're trying to sneak a cookie to bed. You know, obviously you have to do what the game asked you to do. I'm sure it's, you know, I'm happy to see that the problems haven't escalated. You know, the pitchers just do it. And they don't complain about it too much, you know. I think it's one of those things, the current state of baseball, where it's like there's a lot of micromanaging going on, which I'm not happy about, but they don't ask my opinion.
Brendan Wagner up there with an 0-2 count. As Blair tries to get a scoreless second inning here.
They don't want the pitchers having an advantage at all, right?
Well, the game's always, you know, I don't say always, but my generation, the game's built around offense. You know, offense puts fans in the stands, and, you know, as a pitcher, I accept that, you know.
Yep.
It's, you know, they want to see an exciting game. They want to, you know, it's all about revenue, so good for them, you know. But the pitcher's always overcome those type of things, and I did it, you know, in the steroid age, and, you know. You're a better athlete than the hitter. That's all there is.
That was a good pitch there, huh? Got the inside corner with that fastball.
Inside's always open.
That was like a Keith Falk inning right there from Seth Blair. Looked good. Got a couple of punch outs. Great to see
that's
you, Falk.
Thank you for having me. Enjoyed it, guys.
Good to see you. Yep.
Great
so to
much
see
for
you
guys. There he is, Red Sox legend Keith Falk. We go to the bottom of the second inning here. It's 2-0 Scranton. Cool look at St. John's Church lit up at night. Blue Sox trail 2-0 as we go to the bottom of the second inning. It's not too late to get tickets for the remaining home games here at Polar Park. We've got a big weekend coming up, Friday, Saturday, Sunday here, and then a couple more homestands in this inaugural season. Five games have been added to the end of the original schedule too by Minor League Baseball. You can check out that schedule and get all the ticket information you need at WooSox.com. Get them before they're gone. Great night here. Here's Connor Wong to lead off against Boyle. Sean Boyle struck out the first two that he faced. How about Keith Falk, Mike?
Yeah, that was fun. Yeah. Gotten to know him over the years, both of us.
Pops it up. It's foul and it looks like playable for McDowell. It was, and he did not catch it. approaching that foul screen behind home plate. McDowell had an issue, I think, originally trying to pick the ball up, and then he was unable to recover.
That's exactly what happened. Connor Wong, he's happy to get another chance because he had a hanging slider. You're right, McDowell right away didn't see it. Then hit up against the wall there.
I think that Keith Falk, that I've always been amazed, he is as humble as the day is long. I mean, you do not envision a guy who had the success that he has in his career being as mild-mannered, humble, and self-effacing as he is.
And he loves to talk pitching. And I think he did a really good job as transition. That gentleman got the baseball.
And he kept the ice cream in the helmet.
Well, he's got a spoon, too.
Who wants the ball? Who wants the ball? You want a ball? Two and two on Wong. What a series thus far. Connor Wong, over the first three games that he's played against Scranton, 7 out of 11. He's homered, had a three-run double as well earlier tonight. He's driven in 4 runs here in the set. Billy McMillan keeps him in the lineup for this game as the DH. Did he go? Full count.
I think he full. Just from when he talked to us there, realizes what they did. I mean, 86 years without a world championship. It meant so much. There's a gang from Milford, Mass. That's a great baseball town.
3-2 on the hot hitting catcher. He'll stay alive.
I was going to bring up, you know, that was 17 years ago, but I didn't want to do that to him.
Looks good.
He does, but you don't want to make people feel old.
No. 2004. A year that will forever be remembered here in these parts. High in the air to left. Off the end of the bat a little bit. Lamar has it sized up for the first down.
Well, I think this is going to be interesting the second time around because Wong missed 2 sliders that he wants back. Barely missed. This is a really good pitch to hit. Right there. Just got under it. And that's what Boyle throws. A lot of sliders. It's Ryan Lamar.
Yep. Ryan Lamar makes the easy catch as Junior Downs comes into the box. One and nothing on Downs. Earlier tonight, 0 for 2 with a walk in that Blue Sox 2-run win. He had a couple of homers and a doubleheader here Tuesday. On the ground into a shift. That's the second baseman. Alvarez was falling backwards but still made the play. Wow, momentum going into center field, and Armando almost fell onto his fanny, but he still got the out.
In the perfect spot, and the Yankees, they were one of the first to do the shift on the infield, and Downs hit it right to Armando. I think you almost like having this guy play second base. He plays such a great third, but a pretty good second. And a good pick by Wagner.
2 outs, and now Josh Ockamy. He pops it up. It's going to be easier for Alvarez. On the infield dirt, makes it a 1-2-3 frame. And Sean Boyle just continues to put up 0 after 0. Maybe the Yankees found something with this guy. We go to the third. Seth Blair is going to continue in this game. He'll get a third inning. Scranton with a 2-0 lead as we go to the third inning here tonight. Coming up on the 23rd of October, almost 2 months from now, we are trading this diamond for a gridiron. First ever football game at Polar Park will be held between the local guys, the Holy Cross Crusaders, and their Patriot League rivals Colgate. So you can get your tickets today by visiting polarpark.com/Holy Cross. Get a seat on that berm, and maybe a touchdown scorer is going to jump up and visit you.
The polar plunge. That's where Josh and I want to sit out in the berm. Right there to get a great view of a touchdown.
Meanwhile, we start the third inning. Seth Blair, we were told, would go about an inning. Well, he is out there for a third. Gets the top of the order. Jonathan Davis was hit by a pitch to start the game. He stole a base the very next pitch, and then he scored only a moment later, it felt like. Scranton debut for Davis, and he's hit again. Three innings, three hit batters to begin it.
And Davis not happy. He's really trying to pitch in on Davis. He's done it too much. And you know he's running again, Josh. It's just not close. Right above the belt buckle.
Well, the hitters that he's hit have been right-handed hitters. Davis twice and Max McDowell once. But Davis may very well try to steal again on the first pitch. That's what he did back in the first inning. In fact, Scranton did that three times. Brito, first to check over there. Blair learning from the past. Socrates had an RBI single, softly hit to center. That's the only hit of this game. Now two in a row over in that direction.
Yeah, these seven inning games, I mean, that third run is huge if you're the visiting club. So you got to keep Davis close. He can really fly, though.
There he goes on the first pitch again. Pareda with a strong throw. That one is in time. What a cannon from Johnny Pareda. He threw that like a dart.
Well, Josh, even with the pitch out, Davis almost beat it. So you needed a BB from Johnny Pareda, and he has done this so many times. Good jump by Davis. They pitch out, but look at this throw to Jeter Downs. Good scoop. No argument from Davis. Just dejected.
Beautifully done. He is about as good of a catch and throw guy as we've seen here in AAA. Then another hit batter. Top of the slider hits Brito. That's four of them.
He's probably lucky to be down 2-0. Four hit batters.
There's no activity in that Worcester bullpen. It's going to be Blair's fight here in this third. I think Scranton batters, while they can be frustrated by it, they have to know in the forefront of their mind that there is no purpose behind any of this.
Now, there's sliders that are sliding in the wrong spot. Look at. Brito tried to jump away from that pitch.
So now the batter's Ryan Lamar. Good slider. The count goes to 0-1 on Lamar, who popped out in his first at bat tonight and of the series. You know, Ryan got called up during the most recent Yankees COVID issue and ended up hitting a couple of home runs for Aaron Boone's team. A few years ago, he made it up to the big leagues with the Red Sox for a bit. Well traveled is Lamar. There goes the runner. A little pop up into a perfect spot. Base hit Lamar, and all the way to third base goes Brito. How about that? I think because Brito was running on the pitch, Rivera was a little bit out of position, and maybe that's why that ball fell.
Yeah, and Brito just assumed this ball wasn't going to be catch. He never caught. He never slowed down. He just kept running and running. There was one out. So watch Brito. It's a hit and run, but he doesn't even hesitate. He does look over his shoulder a bit. You know, I think Lopez throwing his glove up there gave it away to Brito. That decoy. And there is action in the Worcester bullpen.
And you can see it on that replay too, Mike, as Durbin Feltman gets loose. I beg your pardon. Jaxel Rios gets loose, not Durbin Feltman. But Mike, Rivero was going over to cover the bag. Had he not been doing that, had it not been a hit and run, I think that ball gets caught. So yep. A bit unlucky there for Seth Blair. In fact, both of the hits he's given up have just been tiny little bloopers.
Yeah, and on hit runs, usually you want a ball hit on the ground right side, not something like that. It just worked out.
So Scranton, they've got him on the corners. That's Paul Abbott's pitching coach visit has come to its end. Here comes Armando Alvarez, who struck out in the first. That's the result that Seth Blair would love to replicate. They're on the corners. Infield plays for a double play. On the ground, can they turn it? Jeter Downs over. Relay Rivera. They do turn it. How about that? And that man doesn't have to come in yet. Seth Blair walks the tightrope and gets through it. Still standing. He's gone three innings and a spot start. Seth Blair able to fight his way through a third inning. Now let's see if the offense for the Woo Sox can get something going against Sean Boyle. We've got one more Los Huepas de Worcester night coming up in September. It's part of the Copa de la Diversión in minor league baseball, the Fun Cup. The Woo Sox become Los Huepas one more time. We did it three times this homestand,
yes,
so that was
did.
Like half of the season's Huepas games. We got them all out of the way in these 2 weeks.
A lot of excitement. A lot of fun.
A lot of huepa. That is a Spanish expression of excited happiness presented by La Mega Radio. So here comes Johnny Pareda. And if you want, I know a lot of people do, buy that merchandise. The huepa shirts, caps, they have been flying off the shelves. They look so sharp.
Love the color scheme.
The rocket logo for huepa. Johnny Pareda takes it outside. That's when we get back from the 2 week road trip that's going to follow. Tuesday, September 7th is the final Los Huepas game of the year. That's that cap I'm talking about with the rocket.
Looks like he just bought that cap.
I bought one too.
You did?
Yeah. I wanted to make sure I had it just in case. Needed a weight by in the booth. Out of play, 2-2. This is the close-up look at the weight by cap. It's got the rocket and then 508.
That's great.
Yeah.
I won't steal it from you. Promise.
Go put it on?
Yeah.
Come on. See how you look. Oh, that's sharp.
Is that weight by?
Yes. Very weight by. On the ground is short. Kyle Holder has plenty of time, but the catcher running. And Johnny Pareda becomes the first out. This Sean Boyle. Mike, I get the feeling that he's going to stick around on this Scranton pitching staff, even though they probably didn't anticipate that when they sent him up from high A and skipped the double A level.
Yeah, and I think you really have to like his composure on the mound. I mean, he looks like he belongs here at Triple A. He's used his slider a lot, and both these pitchers have, but Boyle with a lot of confidence and mowing down these hitters.
Now the number nine hitter, Jaxel, Jeremy Rivera. Jaxel Rios up in the bullpen, still for Worcester, getting ready to come in when we get to the fourth. There's Rios, who was just last week optioned from the big league Red Sox bullpen. He's got that big arm. Ball on a strike on Rivera. He's the second baseman here in this one. Earlier tonight, game one, it was Christian Arroyo. Arroyo looked good. He stole a base. Went 0 for 2 with a walk. Ball on two strikes. So Arroyo's on a rehab assignment as we speak, but not playing in this one. Brian Brazier on the rehab made an appearance and got a win earlier tonight. scoreless inning. He pitched in back-to-back games.
Yeah, and he looked good. That was his best outing. We'll see if that's it for him. And we'll see what the deal is with Arroyo if he plays another game here.
Ball and two strikes on Jeremy Rivera. Talking about it earlier, Danny Santana reportedly very close to starting a rehab assignment too. So the Red Sox are going to have some options getting healthy and perhaps close to coming back to help the big club.
Down the stretch.
The rock in the fire. To short, one hop, Holder. He's made both plays in the inning. Well, the first time through the order, Boyle has retired 8 of the 9, and the only man to reach, it was a walk to Franchi.
Yeah, Franchi had a great at bat there. Pretty amazing, though, the American League East with 4 teams. Now, Toronto needs to pick it up a little bit, but mainly here in the last month, you're 4 teams battling for the playoff spots. There's a great look at the night sky here at Polar Park.
Jack Lopez struck out to begin this. Boyle just keeps pumping him in. 24 of those 37 pitches he's thrown have been for strikes. Well, you talk about the AL East. Red Sox now today after a Tampa win. They are 6.5 games behind the Rays for first. But just a game behind the Yankees. Even after being swept by New York, of course, they didn't want to be a game behind. You never thought they would have as recently as a month ago, but they are. But a game that's very manageable. And with the Texas Rangers, a very struggling Texas Rangers team coming to Fenway this weekend. Chance for Boston to get things right.
For Sale, that's the stopper. That's what you want after losing streak.
Into center field, and how about Sean Boyle? Jonathan Davis takes that one. It's 3 hitless and scoreless. Boyle has thrown 7 shutout innings against Worcester after coming up from A-ball. We go to the fourth. It's still 2-0.
All Thursday, WUSOX College Nights are presented by Christie Campus Health. Christie Campus Health, supporting the mental health and well-being of college students. You can learn more at ChristieCampus.com. Scranton with a 2-run first inning. Seth Blair didn't have any walks in 3 innings, but he hit 4 batters, but only gave up 2 runs, 2 hits. He struck out 4, had 2 wild pitches. And our pitching change is presented by Shaw's, the official grocery partner of the Worcester Red Sox. Yaxel Rios, who was with the Red Sox, now here in Worcester in his second appearance with the WUSOX.
Well traveled this season. Started the year in the Rays organization, over to the Mariners, and then the Red Sox getting him off of waivers. He was good, 20 games in the big leagues for Alex Cora coming out of the bullpen. But you know, Mike, one of the worst things that can happen to you as a middle reliever, it's if you have options.
Yes.
They have to make decisions. Well, he had minor league options, and so here he is. You got to be down here for at least 10 days.
He'll face at PETA, Max McDowell, and Kyle Holder. Rios works from the stretch at all times. Throws hard, misses low. 95 with a fastball.
We saw him sitting in the upper 90s when he made his WUSOX debut here on Sunday.
Fastball, slider, changeup. PETA struck out his first time against Blair. And that's in there. Well, the Red Sox have had a lot of different arms in that bullpen. 2021, we of course saw a lot last year. Hit hard, base hit. Cordero very deep in left. And Matt PETA loves hitting in this ballpark, as do a lot of the RailRiders.
And he got a hanger here from Rios. Tried to go with the breaking ball, just left it up in the zone. Take a look at where this pitch is. Right there. So the leadoff man for Scranton has reached all 4 innings, although this is the first time that it wasn't on a hit by pitch.
Not sure I've ever seen that. Three straight innings. Leadoff man reaching via the hit batter. McDowell was one back in the second. Econ product. And 12 games with AAA Durham this year, Rios was 2-0 with a .66 ERA. I think the command sometimes is the issue. He's got a really good arm. So Blair now Rios, a bullpen game. And it's 2-0.
I think the Woo Sox might lead the league in bullpen games.
I know it sounds weird. A reliever starting, it's still technically called the bullpen game.
Yeah, basically what we mean by saying bullpen game is that somebody who generally would have been a reliever goes first. Because then that means they're not going to go that deep. So you got to use a lot more of those guys.
There's a lot more in that pen this year with the expanded rosters. The debut for Rios with Worcester was against Syracuse in the 15th. He went one inning, two hits, and a run. It's a 6-1 Syracuse win. Allowed an RBI single to Wilfredo Tovar. That revamped Mets lineup. Well, like Scranton here. This one's dropped. It's a strike. And into second base will be Matt Pita. So a drop pitch and Pita takes second base.
Yeah, it's been a very interesting four innings for Johnny Pareda behind the plate. Had to deal with all the wild stuff and stolen bases when Seth Blair was on the hill. Here he just drops a pitch. It's almost a strike. I think he was trying to frame it and just did not look the ball into the glove. It was a strike, in fact.
Yes.
Called it a strike. Well, then I guess they can't rule it a wild pitch.
That one runs down and in again. Should be a pass ball.
I think by definition it would have to be.
Has to be, right? We'll make it the official, Josh. That's a big run out there. Fourth inning. This is a seven inning game. Blue Sox won the first one 5-3. Scranton did rally late, but Ort shut the door. That's right down the middle. 97. Get some hard throwers in that pen now with Rios and Adames.
The closer, Caleb Ort, he can touch 96, 97 as well. Did a good job. Got a double play to end that win earlier tonight, 5-3. Big pitch here for Joxel Rios.
Kyle Holder, the on deck hitter. And he just missed. Just below the strike zone. So a walk. That is the first of the game for the Woo Sox pitchers. You'd think there'd be more. All the hit batters kind of clouds that. Now let's see if Holder bunts here. It's an interesting situation. It's the lower part of the order. And you do have the left-handed hitter against the right-handed pitcher. Now the Woo Sox play it for a bunt. Holder does square and takes it low.
Sometimes you get a guy that's been up in the major leagues for the majority of the season. When you come back to the minors, it's hard to replicate the same kind of adrenaline rush that you get on a big league mound. I wonder if that's been the case here, because Syracuse had some success, as you said, as well on Sunday when Rios first came to Worcester. Tonight he just doesn't look as sharp as he did for much of the time that he pitched with Boston.
It's a big spot, but they're giving you an out, so you got to throw a strike. See that bunt defense. Holder gets it down. Nice job there by De La Guerra. Picked it up right when it went foul. I really think in this situation you would actually take the bunt here, because I think Rios has the ability. You've got Burt, inexperienced hitter, then Wagner. He can strike those guys out.
No question about that. You gotta like Joxel Rios' chances against the bottom of this lineup. Holder, you know, sometimes sometimes they're working on things too. Maybe Kyle Holder's working on a sacrifice in this situation. Now the Woo Sox very rarely ever sacrifice. Different organizations have different philosophies on it in the minor leagues.
Sometimes they have a hitter. There's Billy McMillan. They'll let a hitter bunt once. If it doesn't work, they'll take it off, hoping he gets a fastball to hit. So Rios in a pickle, and I think he was trying to see what was going on. He just yelled boo, I think, to PETA.
I think Jeter's kind of sneaky funny out there. Jeter Downs always has a quip that has the base runner crack a smile. You notice that?
Yeah. Just throws in just a one word line.
Yep.
It's all about timing with jokes.
It's not quite Jairo Munoz level of constant smile, but Jeter generally looks like he's enjoying himself out on the field, doesn't he?
Yeah, someone has to pick it up with Jairo not playing. That's a 3-1 count now, so they take the bunt away. And Rios is a pitch from loading the bases. I doubt they would bunt 3-1. I've seen it.
If they did, I got a bridge in Brooklyn for you.
It's,
you
know? Good hit and run count as a strike with the fastball.
Good pitch, 96. It's a pitcher's pitch, too. This isn't middle. That's right on the outside black and hits the glove of Pareda exactly where he set it up.
Well, they're making Rios work here in the fourth. Still nobody outs. Fans want the strikeout. Tap pitch. They get it. High fastball. That was a good spot for Rios to go, and Holder chased it.
Yeah, it's such an effective pitch. When you go up the ladder with that kind of velocity, you just can't touch that. As the sound system indicates, MC Hammer can't touch this.
Perfect song for that. Former Bat Boy, you know. Did you know that?
Didn't he try to play with the Oakland A's?
He was a Bat Boy,
for the A's.
Yeah.
MC.
That's where he grew up.
But like MC, Mike, you are too legit to quit.
Do you think he told the players that I'm going to be a rapper someday? But yeah, you're a big MC Hammer fan, right?
Hey, hey, yeah. Hell yeah.
Did you do the dance? It's Mauer time.
You can't touch this. Yeah, Mauer time. Hi, guys.
We're having fun here tonight at Nesson Plus. Thanks for joining us. Woo Sox trying to sweep this twin bill.
They haven't done that in any of their home doubleheaders. This would be the first one if they could come back and win this game.
Max Burt, the hitter. He grounded out his first time. So Rios trying to dip into trouble and get out of it. And this will be an infield fly as it's Jeter Downs. Two outs. So Burt, first pitch swinging, and he probably figures, I get a fastball to hit, I'm chasing it. And now Wagner will bat with two outs. You're right, Jeter's having a good time out there.
I like that. I mean, hey, you're going to play baseball for 5 or 6 hours here today. They're going to finish a fifth game in just over 50 hours here since Tuesday. Might as well have a good time while you're doing it. Otherwise, the lethargy of the situation could set in.
No dog days of August for Jeter. Wagner struck out looking his first time. Number 9 hitter.
I mean, that's a lot of baseball. Right? Think about that. We started this at 4:30 on Tuesday. And by, let's say, 10 o'clock tonight, they're going to play 5 games.
And even though we started that game on Tuesday in the 6th, the second game was 9 innings. And when we resumed, we had so many runs. That game took a while to finish. Breaking ball in there from Yaxel Rios, so it's 1-1.
But God willing, we're just going to feel like it's a walk in the park when you play single games on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Just 9 innings, that's it. Like having a day off.
And we'll have you covered here right on Nesson Plus. 1 and 2. And Josh, you have to put up with me now not only two nights, three nights.
Au contraire, Mike, I have the pleasure of putting up with you tomorrow and Saturday.
Rios one pitch away from getting out of two on and nobody outs, keeping the Woo Sox in the game. And he will with that slider. Wagner frozen, and Rios gets out of the inning. He had to throw a lot of pitches, but scoreless in the end, and we're halfway through at Polar Park. Yoxel Rios gets out of that inning, freezing Brandon Wagner. It's two on and nobody out.
Beautiful slider, too, and Wagner just couldn't get the bat off his shoulder. He was frozen by that pitch.
Traveling to a Woo Sox game, then visit the Hilton Garden Inn of Worcester, the official hotel of the Worcester Red Sox. It's where the Rail Riders are staying while they're in town this week. I'm sure they're getting in the Uber and experiencing the great eats of Worcester.
They've been here so much over the last 2 months. This is their third trip here. Probably feels like they need to pay Massachusetts residence taxes.
Yeah, there's Keith Falk. Look at signing on the berm. A lot of commotion out there for good reason.
It's nice having him here in the booth. Now he gets to go interact with the rest of the ballpark. That's really neat.
De La Guerra could not time up that breaking ball. Sean Boyle has been throwing that pitch a lot, the slider, and he's allowed just a walk over three scoreless. That was Cordero in the first. He's on deck. De La Guerra struck out his first time. Chad, well-traveled veteran. He's got power. De La Guerra, Cordero, and Joey Meneses. Again, Sean Boyle. He's pitched at three levels this year. Low A, high A, and now Triple A. Skip Somerset. One ball, two strikes. Pitched two seasons at Dallas Baptist University after two at Suffolk County Community College in New York. Went to Newfield High School in Selden, New York, and pitching for a Yankees affiliate. And tight on De La Guerra, 2-2.
As we've talked about, the moment doesn't seem too big for Boyle, having skipped the double A level. He's been super effective in his three outings now at Triple A. There's our folks from Milford posing for a picture.
To second base, Alvarez has been busy in this doubleheader. There's one out. You're right. I mean, he looks very cool, collected on the mound. It's a good trade, I think. A lot of guys that have that. I mean, that's. I thought Clark Schmidt had that last night. It's a big moment when you come up here from A-ball.
Be the opposite of the great Mark Fidrich. Talking about demeanor on the mound. But he's got a little bit of that hitch in the giddy up. Other than that, nothing flamboyant about Sean Boyle out there. Mark Fidrich, Central Mass's zone.
Mark's almost like a fictional character. Cordero's the only base runner for the Woo Sox. He walked back in the first.
I think people forget how good Mark Fidrich was when he first came up to the big leagues. That first season with the Tigers when he was the American League Rookie of the Year was one of the most unbelievable rookie campaigns coming up that baseball's ever had for a pitcher.
Not an easy ballpark to pitch in, too. Tiger Stadium, the old one. Hitters Park. He was something. He built that legend so quickly. Long night for the boys. They want to end this with a sweep, but they'll have to rally back here against a very good pitcher here, Boyle, who misses 3-1.
This is the one guy that he's been a little more careful with, and I guess for good reason. The only base runner thus far tonight for Worcester was Franchi.
Overshift on the right side for the power hitter. He took a big swing and fouled it.
And you knew he wasn't going to give in there. 3-1, gave him the breaking ball. Crunchy out in front, hooks and foul. Remember, Mark Fidrich came back, signed a minor league deal with the Red Sox in the early 80s. Pitched a couple of seasons for the old Paw Sox.
Payoff pitch, and he got him. He went right after him with a 90-mile-an-hour fastball with some sink. That's his third strikeout.
Well, he didn't give into him 3-1, but 3-2. Take a look where this pitch is. You called it, Mike. Fastball right there. Franchi Cordero unable to touch it.
I wonder if Franchi was just fooled. Fidrich went to Worcester Academy High School. And he pitched in a famous game, right?
Absolutely, yes. McCoy Stadium against Dave Rigetti.
There's a ball high to Joey Meneses.
1982. One of the most famous games in a Paw Sox or Red Sox AAA history, for that matter. Rigetti had just been optioned from the major leagues a year after he won the Rookie of the Year. So both of those pitchers, Fidrich and Rigetti, had been AL Rookies of the Year.
Big Stein wasn't happy at the time with Rigetti.
That's right.
There's a Worcester native in the middle there with the pen, Rich Gedman.
Pretty good baseball tradition coming out of here, huh?
Yeah. Meneses to left, but got under it. Ryan Lamar puts the fourth inning to rest. So the Woo Sox go in order. Sean Boyle is cooking with gas here tonight. Four hitless innings in game two of this doubleheader. Some of the best places to enjoy a game at Polo Park are also the most affordable. A general admission ticket gives you access to every red seat in the building, as well as the berm, the craft corner, the triple-decker garden, and the home plate bar. We have GA seats available for every game the rest of the year for as little as $9. Everyone having a good time tonight. Craft corner.
GA tickets, Mike. We can't overemphasize how good of a deal that is, because there are so many great locations you can watch the game from just with a general admission ticket. Pick the different spots, maybe try multiple areas during the game, see which one you like the best.
I mean, you're close there to the pizza. That's a win. You're on the berm. Win there.
I think the berm is where I'd go, but people keep telling me I got to experience the craft corner during one of these games. Nobody ever lets me out of the booth. That's the problem. Like a caged animal.
And it would cost you $9, by the way.
Well, I think that'd be well worth it.
Rios to Davis. Davis is happy to see a pitch not hit him. He's been hit twice. Led off the game, he was hit on the second pitch, stole second, scored on a Brito single. Brito's on deck, then Lamar for the Yankees AAA club. It's 2-0 as that one slips. Kind of an awkward look from Rios. You just hope when a guy slips that he's all right. He's mad at himself.
It did rain a little bit earlier with the tarp off the field before the start and right after the beginning of game one tonight.
3-0. Fastball had some juice on it, 95. Now Rios has thrown 23 pitches but only 11 strikes. He did work a scoreless fourth after the first two reached. Get out of it. 3-1.
Trying to do something that hasn't been done yet for a Woo Sox pitcher in this game. Retire the leadoff batter.
Four innings? Four. Yeah, how about that? Two runs came in the first inning. Brito RBI scored on a wild pitch. Hitter's count, line drive, base hit, and a center for Davis. It was 1-for-2 stealing. I will say he'll run again.
Boy, nice debut with Scranton for Jonathan Davis. Longtime Blue Jay. Just got sent down onto the farm and been on base all three times he's come up. I'm with you, Mike. Thinking he's probably going to try to run at some point. Got a fastball here. Center cut. put a nice swing on it. He's such a good base runner and a good defensive outfielder that if he could hit just even a little bit more than he has in the major leagues, he'd still be up.
Strike one to Brito. So all five innings, leadoff man is reached. See Brito and RBI. A single. He also has a steal. And was hit by a pitch in the third. Seth Blair, the starter, hit four, but could have been a lot worse. I mean, if you have the leadoff man reach five innings, now this inning not over yet, but you're lucky it's just 2-0. Could be worse.
Absolutely. Done a good job minimizing damage and pitching through trouble.
Davis does not run. It's hit up the middle. Good effort there by Downs. And now the sneak throw back in, and it gets by everybody. Luckily backed up by Pareda. So two on and nobody out. Hard hit singles by Davis and Brito.
What a day for Socrates Brito. Been on base five times now in the doubleheader. Just going after pitch that was right there. Up. Got the arms extended, hit it off the slope of the mound. That catapulted it past the dive of Cheater Downs. And look, Davis wanted to try to go to third. And Jack Lopez, I'm not sure if he was really certain where he was throwing that baseball.
Yeah, it didn't look like he was throwing it back to second base. So for the second straight inning, Rios has allowed the first two to reach with nobody out. And Ryan Lamar, veteran hitter. These two have seen each other in the past. Lamar is 1-for-2. Ball one is high. So a big spot here for both clubs. The Rail Riders like their arm that they have tonight. Boyle, who's not allowed a hit in four innings. So they feel a 3 or 4-0 lead might be enough. They've got an excellent bullpen as well. Way to the fastball.
No need for that bullpen as yet. Sean Boyle going hitless through the first four. He's been very economical in doing so, Mike. He's only thrown 54 pitches.
It's just one base runner.
Quiet night at the Kraft Corner for the moment. And over there on the bullpen terrace. That's right behind the Woo Sox bullpen.
1-1 on Ryan Lamar playing left field here in game two. He was idle in game one. Davis can run. You can see him at second base. Good pitch there, but Lamar did not bite. Lamar went 4 of 21 with the Yankees, but hit two home runs, as you mentioned earlier. 290 hitter in the minors this year with 5 home runs. Swing and a miss. Good fastball, 97.
Wow. And you know, Mike, sometimes, the velocity is good, but it's where do you locate it? This is perfect. Watch this. Inside corner, just around the knees, almost an untouchable pitch. Throw a 97 and put it at that spot.
And that's why Rios can get out of an inning like this. He's already struck out too.
Does he stay with the hard stuff or does he try to go to his breaking ball to put Lamar away? Lamar's not a guy that chases out of the zone very often.
Fastball, maybe?
I would.
Really paying attention to Davis, which makes sense. Ooh. Slip there.
Man.
Well, Josh, earlier in this inning, remember he had a bad grip on a pitch to Davis.
Boy, does this change the complexion of the inning. Now you got two in scoring position. That just slipped over the head of Lamar.
Third wild pitch of the game for the Woo Sox arms. Blair had two. Now the infield has to come in. Fifth inning is late in a 7-inning game. And I'll tell you what, if Lamar bloops one to left, it's going to score two runs because Cordero is playing near the berm. that's an exaggeration, but there's such separation between the left side of the infield and Cordero. I mean, look at that.
Well, Rio's looking for the punch out or the pop up here.
He brings it and gets him. Lamar not happy. What a pitch right on the inner part.
How about Juxel Rios going back to his breaking ball here, 3-2. Coming right over the inside corner. I think that's a strike. Good pitch. Lamar, just a brief discussion with the home plate umpire Cody Oaks about it. Infield will stay in now, but you got one out.
Time to read the hat. It's weird to see a pitcher give the catcher a signal. Indicator 2. Alvarez is struck out and hit into an inning-ending double play in the third. Infield is still in. Rivera and Downs, they back away just a little bit.
Start to see your way out of the inning after getting that punch out of Lamar. Alvarez just 1-for-13 in the series, Mike. Make a few more good pitches, you got a chance to do it.
Yeah, look how many he's thrown. A lot of pitches. And Scranton has had tons of opportunities with runners in scoring position. Despite a 2-0 lead, they're 1-for-10 in this one. And we're in the fifth inning. 1-for-10 with runners in scoring position. There's a lot of communication breakdown here.
Yeah, it's amazing how easy it is to subvert the pitch clock when you got runners on base. It's just been turned off.
This one hit to center field. Lopez was shallow. He backpedals to make the catch, and both runners will advance. So Davis speeds in, and Scranton's lead is 3-0 as Alvarez with the sack fly to center, and a big run for Scranton in the fifth.
Yes, it was, Mike. Good job by Armando Alvarez to get a good piece of this ball. Missed his spot there with that fastball.
Easy.
Plenty deep enough to get the runner in.
Yeah, and for both runners to advance.
The wild pitch really, as we said, changed the whole inning. That run doesn't score without it.
Pita, strike one with the fastball.
And with the way that Sean Boyle's been pitching, 3-0 lead feels like a big, tall mountain that the Blue Sox have to climb here. They've only got 9 outs left to work with.
Yeah, it's weird how games have a feel to it, but the other pitcher makes this 3-0 lead almost feel like 5-0. So wild pitches have hurt. Brito scored on one in the first, and the wild pitch here helped create the run. Pita struck out in the first, singled, advanced on a pass ball in the fourth. Here's Brito. He was reached base in 5 straight plate appearances in this doubleheader. He struck out in AB1 off Gossett a long time ago. I would say, what, 3-4 hours ago?
You would be correct. 3.5 to be exact.
Started the second game at 7:39 on the East Coast. Rios trying to get out of the inning, and he does. Swing and a miss. Pita chased a high fastball. So Rios does have 4 strikeouts, but that's a big run for Scranton in the top of the fifth on that sack fly by Alvarez. All Scranton here in game 2 at Polar Park. Well, the Rail Riders add a run in the top of the fifth inning. A sack fly by Alvarez. The Blue Sox Foundation is dedicated to the fight against cancer, which is why all donations for tonight's game will be donated to the Jimmy Fund. Visit WooSoxFoundation.org to donate and learn more about our efforts to conquer cancer.
And this is a very near and dear night to the hearts of many here in the Woo Sox organization. Jimmy Fund Night here. We had Larry Lucchino coming on. He's been a long time chairman of the Jimmy Fund. and announcing today that the Woo Sox are officially forming a partnership with the Jimmy Fund, as the Red Sox have for so many decades.
It was nice having Larry on in game one. Getting ready for their 19th annual WEEI Ness and Jimmy Fund Radio Telethon, August 24th and 25th. Woo Sox need a hit. Connor Wong to right, but that will die foul. How about Sean Boyle? He is the story here in game two. One base runner, a walk with two outs in the first, two Cordero.
Second time the charm there from Socrates Brito, getting that souvenir up to the craft corner for those kids.
They love him now. That should be it for Rios. Worcester's bullpen is cooking. Foul ball. Long fly to left his first time. There they are.
Yeah, Brito threw it up there once, that foul ball, and it got dropped right back into the. As Austin Bryce getting heated up. Spent a lot of the year in the big leagues for the Red Sox early on this season. Been very good the times that he's pitched here with the Woo Sox.
Long behind in the count to third base. Max Burt running in, throwing. And Wagner handles it, one out, so Wong is 0 for 2, and Jeter Downs will hit. Josh Ockamy's on deck. And it's already interesting. I mean, you got to remember, it's the fifth inning of a seven-inning game here.
Yeah, it's getting late early. The Woo Sox still looking for a hit. They haven't really even hit the ball hard very much. The soft contact again there from Connor Wong. Max Burt knew exactly how much time he had. Got him by half a step at first base. Really, the only piece of solid contact that I can remember, Mike, was Jeter Downs' ground out back in the second inning.
Alvarez made a nice play on that. Well, Sean Boyle's did a nice job just changing the eye level. Hasn't thrown a ton of fastballs. He's had good location all night. Spins one in again. Quite the outing for Sean Boyle.
No kidding. Pitch count very manageable too.
Three strikeouts in the ball game. Has that little delay in his windup. As Downs out in front. Three sliders in a row. Again, Alvarez from up here calling for it. Two outs. You can just see how off balance all the hitters are.
The first baseman.
Now let's see if Ockamy can do something here with two outs. He popped the second his first time. Ockamy was 1 for 3 in the first game. He started that long inning in game one. Worcester sent 9 to the plate, 4 scored. Ockamy doubled. And strike one.
So the game can be so easy for a pitcher, Mike, when you're throwing strikes, locating where you want your stuff. 38 of 60 have been strikes.
That's a very good number. Strike two.
Man.
Good sink on this pitch.
Yeah, Ockamy unable to pull the trigger. Now he's all right batting with two strikes on him. Doesn't bother him the way it bothers some hitters. So he's okay to take strike two there.
Overshift on the right side for him, and that just missed. That was a fastball. He's done that a few times, used the fastball as the out pitch. And he nearly fooled Ockamy, who is great at flipping counts. I've nicknamed him Mr. 3-2. So many of those counts. And he strikes out. A high breaking ball. Boyle with a perfect inning. He has been something else as we head to the sixth. Scranton leads here 3-0 in game two on Nesson Plus.
All hands on deck night. That's some of Woo Sox front office staff helping with the infield drag.
Doing a great job.
We go to the sixth, and it's 3-0 Scranton hoping to split this doubleheader. Do you want to get an up-close look at this new gym? Well, Polar Park tours are now available every week, Mondays through Saturdays. Get all the information and purchase your tickets for the behind-the-scenes tour of the new home of the WooSox by visiting WooSox.com/tours. Show you around everywhere you want to see. You want to go into the DCU club? We'll take you there. Take a look at the broadcast booths. Check out the craft corner, the Hanover deck, the berm. Just purchase your ticket for the WooSox Polar Park tours. There's Austin Bryce, third pitcher of the game for the WooSox. Now the big story that is building is what's happening in the AAA starting debut for Sean Boyle. He's got a no-hitter in progress through five. However, the WooSox trying to keep the deficit at three runs with six outs left to work with as Bryce enters in back of Yaxel Rios. Max McDowell. All five leadoff batters in this game have reached base for Scranton, including McDowell when he was hit by a pitch back in the second. He's gotten two free passes. You see, he also walked. And it looks like they're going to do it. Leadoff batter is out. Catch by Joey Meneses in right field. But Mike, it hasn't been the major league season that Austin Bryce would have hoped for the Boston Red Sox, but I tell you, he has been phenomenal for the Worcester Red Sox.
Yeah, and that's exactly what you want to see. Guy that had some struggles in the big leagues, but he comes down here and has had great numbers. 1.37 ERA, a lot of strikeouts, and turning his season around.
Just three runs allowed in now, 20 AAA innings pitched, and only 11 hits. AAA East is batting a paltry 169 against Mr. Bryce. So with one out, here's Kyle Holder, who struck out each time. Takes a big cut at that fastball.
Sean Boyle, by the way, is retired 13 in a row, 15 of 16 for the game. Up in the zone to Holder at no chance.
Kyle Holder 2-for-9 in the series. It's 1-1 if you're curious, by the way. The longest outing of the season for Boyle is in progress. He had never gotten through five innings in any of his appearances with low A Tampa, high A Hudson Valley, or Scranton prior to tonight. So, Mike, you'll wonder how long are they going to let him go. But the bullpen is at the moment quiet for the RailRiders on their side.
Don't always factor in what's going on in the game when it's about protecting a prospect. I mean, even in the big leagues now, they won't let guys go long for no hitters.
It was just off the plate. Good fastball from Bryce. And a better take by Kyle Holder. Yeah, the longest appearance as far as outs recorded all season for Boyle prior to this game was his last one. Last Thursday against Lehigh Valley, 4 1/3. He's made it through five runless and hitless here in this game, and he's apparently going to go back out for the bottom of the sixth. Breaking ball struck him out. That's a beauty of a slider for Bryce. Two yeah, down.
Just about to say that. What a pretty pitch. Nine strikeouts in the game for the WooSox pitchers. Watch how he commands this. It's down in the zone. Unhittable.
Two up, two down. The batter's Max Burt, local product, who has grounded out, popped out. Starting four straight games here in this series.
Probably had to borrow some of the players' tickets, mask guy. Can I use your tickets for the pass list?
You know, I was impressed that Keith Volk knew a lot about the Northeastern hockey program when we brought up that Max Burt played his college baseball at NU, about 40 miles to the east of here. Keith Volk said, good hockey program.
He is a big hockey guy, loves the Bruins. Think Smiley Ball likes hockey?
Yeah, I bet. out of play. 1-2 on a bird. I think Smiley probably be very graceful on the ice.
We'll have to find out this offseason here in Worcester.
Posing right below us. Probably takes a lot of selfies. Burt spoils that fastball for Bryce. How many of these do you think he has to pose for over the course of a doubleheader like today?
I would make him do 200 per game. Yeah.
Dozens, if not hundreds. Another 1-2. We'll do it again. This is a college night. Thursday nights all are. Speaking of Northeastern, a lot of great colleges in the Worcester area, too. Presented by Christie Campus Health. 3-0 is the lead for the visitors. Max Burt just keeps battling against Austin Bryce. Earlier tonight, if you weren't with us, game one of the Twin Bill was won by Worcester, final score 5-3. So these teams have split four games. And including this one, still four to go here in this long week between the Yankees and the Red Sox AAA farm clubs. Worcester held without a hit in this seven-inning game through the first five innings. Another foul ball.
He's following off whatever he throws. The slider, the fastball. There's Gyro, who left the first game with an injury, but it's good he's smiling.
Gyro Munoz got hit in the foot, the right foot, with a pitch several hours ago and had to be removed from game one. Not in there for the nightcap either. You hope that he's going to be able to return this weekend. Who knows? Try it again. Fouled off again. That's six straight foul balls by Max Burt. Now the ninth pitch of the at-bat forthcoming. Mano a mano battle. Put in play on the ground. At the shortstop, Jeter downs. Burt really wanted that, but he is out on the ninth pitch that he sees. And Austin Bryce continues to put up zeros here with the Woo Sox. 1-2-3. But the story is on the right arm of Sean Boyle. He's back to work in the bottom of the sixth. Blue Sox trail 3-0 as they come to bat looking for their first hit. It'll be Johnny Barreto to lead off the home sixth in a seven-inning game. All Thursday, Woo Sox College Nights are presented by Christie Campus Health. Christie Campus Health, supporting the mental health and well-being of college students. Learn more at christiecampus.com. Well, it's already been the longest outing of 2021 for Sean Boyle. However, he has more work to do, Mike Antonellis. He has only given up one base runner, a walk, with two out in the first inning.
13 straight, he's retired, 15 of 16 in the game. He has struck out four, he's done it with that sinking fastball and the slider. It's really had the hitters off balance.
Johnny Barreda and Jeremy Rivera, the first two due up, the 8 and 9 hitters in the order, each grounded out to the shortstop back in the third. A rock and a fire. We've got a lot of swings like that against that slider.
It's like Barreda just didn't pick this up.
High in the air in the left. Playable for Lamar. Boyle is five outs away.
Just total domination.
Second baseman, number 54, Jeremy Rivera.
again, I'll say that there has hardly even been what you'd consider very hard, solid contact throughout the outing thus far for Mr. Boyle. That one was off the end of the bat. So can it be Jeremy Rivera to break it up? Grounded out his first time, batting out of the nine hole. Strike one.
A lot of pitches like that. 90 miles an hour. But would sink.
One ball, one strike. Remember the Woo Sox without Jairo Munoz, as we talked about. Delino DeShields Jr., who's been a regular for a couple of weeks, has not played in either game of this doubleheader. And Johan Mieses is on the bench for this one as well.
I can see those three.
Hit him. And Rivera's angry about it. But he is a base runner, which is something that the Woo Sox have been seeking for quite some time.
Yeah, the tying runs on deck. I mean, you want base runners here. I think Rivera's just hurts and he's mad. He's not mad at Boyle, you wouldn't think.
Definitely doesn't feel good when you get hit up on the arm like that.
No. That can knock you out for a couple weeks, too.
He's still smarting a bit, you can tell, as he talks with first base coach Bruce Crabb. So five outs left to work with. Worcester trails by three. Here comes the top of the order with Jack Lopez. Lopez struck out and flied out to center, so 0 for 2. His only hit of the series came in game one today. He almost got hit. I'm a little surprised that Scranton does not have any activity working in its bullpen, considering that this is the longest outing, at least as far as outs recorded all season by Boyle, by an inning.
And it's 3-0. It's not like it's 5-6-0.
Chopped to the right side and a play for the second baseman Alvarez. He is four outs away. Up to second advances Rivera, but now two gone.
Good read by Alvarez. He was playing up the middle on this and he had to get to it quickly. He was off to the races. See how quick it got to the ball and actually got in front of it. Made the play easily.
So now it's Boyle versus Chad De La Guerra, playing in his first game in over a week. They have struck out and grounded to second base. You wonder how's the timing in the batter's box for De La Guerra, having gone so long without having seen live pitching. Blue Sox are down to their final four outs. Chasing the slider. Again, nothing in one.
That slider chases left-handed hitters. This almost hit De La Guerra. Where this pitch ends up. Back leg.
I think it's worth reiterating again that this is the first ever start at the AAA level for Sean Boyle. On the ground and foul, it's nothing in two. In fact, it's the first game he's ever started above a ball. And he is four outs away from a no-no.
And pretty good indications he'll have a second AAA start.
The Dallas Baptist product, the strike away from getting through six, scoreless and hitless. 0-2. De La Guerra lays off. If Chad De La Guerra could figure out a way to reach base here, then you'd bring Franchi Cordero up, representing the tying run of this game.
That's why you could see Boyle be very aggressive here to De La Guerra. I mean, all of his pitches move. That looked like a cutter that just darted to the right at the last minute.
1-2 pitch. Good take, 2-2.
Same spot. Same pitch.
It is a ball.
Nice try, McDowell.
Just now, Scranton finally, for the first time tonight, getting a reliever up and throwing in the pen. Boyle trying to finish the sixth. Have to try it again against Chad De La Guerra.
It's a good at bat by De La Guerra. That I think the best at bat was earlier in the game when Connor Wong fouled off so many pitches and then ended up flying to left. Been some deep at bats. Cordero, of course, his walk.
It's Nick Nelson just back from the big league Yankees who's getting loose. 2-2 again. Two out. Setting up for a high fastball. Close, but ball three.
Give De La Guerra credit. He's not chased. I wonder if Nelson would come in to face Cordero in this spot if he loses him.
The Woo Sox would love to find out the answer to your question. So it was 0-2. It's now 3 balls, 2 strikes. He struck him out. What a pitch. And Boyle, 6 hitless innings. What a Triple-A starting debut for the right-hander, 24-year-old, with the night of his life thus far. 3-0 remains the Scranton lead. Seventh and final inning coming up. The Woo Sox still with zeros in the run and hit columns. Well, tonight's Booster Club and Woo Crew code word of the game is reliever. As in, are the Rail Riders going to go to a reliever to try to finish a no-hitter? That'll be a cliffhanger. The Woo Sox Booster Club is open to fans of all ages and is presented by Window World, while the Woo Crew is for children ages 15 and under and is presented by Shaw's. If you're not a member of either one, you can sign up for free at WooSox.com to earn exclusive Booster Club or Woo Crew member benefits. Austin Bryce, in his second inning of relief, deals with the number 9 batter, Brandon Wagner. Now, Mike, the question for Doug Davis to answer. You've got a young man who had not gone more than 4 1/3 innings in any outing all season. They have gotten him through 6. Could you leave him out there for a 7th inning to try to finish something historic?
That's a tough one. I got to think about that. I think if he's fatigued and can't go, you can't do it. But if he feels like he has enough bullets, let him do it.
Meanwhile, 3-0 on Wagner, who struck out looking each of the first 2 times he batted. Once against Blair and once against Joxel Rios. Nick Nelson was throwing in that bullpen last inning. Not at the moment. That doesn't mean he's not going to come in. Ball 4. 4-pitch walk. So that means in 6 of the 7 innings of this game, Scranton got the leadoff man aboard.
Yeah, with Nelson already getting loose, they might wait until 2 outs to get him hot again, as they say.
Very interesting note. Sean Boyle was part of a no-hitter already this season when he was in High A Hudson Valley back on the 10th of July. He went the first 4 innings of a combined no-hitter against Brooklyn in that one. Jonathan Davis has been on all 3 times. Take strike 1 here from Bryce.
We're getting all these notes in. Cooper Boardman just telling us this would be the 30th in the minors this year.
Now, you do see them significantly more frequent in these doubleheader 7-inning games. 0-1 on the speedster Jonathan Davis. Another get 2. Twice been hit by Seth Blair pitches. And singled and scored against Rios. In fact, this man in his Rail Riders debut, Davis, has scored 2 of the 3 Scranton runs.
He's been a catalyst in that leadoff spot.
Very close. Ball one, though, I guess a little bit tall. I guess.
Yep. Maybe a hair outside.
Brace had a 1-2-3 inning in the sixth. But in the trouble here in the seventh, trying to keep the deficit at three. Strike three called that time. Austin Brace does get the call, one out.
10 strikeouts for Woo Sox pitchers. Blair four, Rios four, Bryce with two.
Hit your spot, get the call, right?
Yes. Almost looked like the previous pitch. Maybe a little bit better, little lower in the zone.
One out, one on for Socrates Brito. Just like Jonathan Davis, not retired in this game, at least as yet. 2-for-2, he's also been hit by a pitch. Brito's been on base five times in the doubleheader. Got four hits. Well, due up in the bottom of the last inning, that's the seventh. Woo Sox have the meat of their order. 3-4-5, Cordero, Meneses, and Wong. The question is, who's the pitcher going to be? It's 2-0 on the lefty, Socrates Brito.
I think we'll know with two outs. If Nelson starts throwing with two outs, then he's coming in. Or they let Boyle start, and if he gives up one hit, then they take him out.
Line drive, there's another hit for Brito. Into the gap in left center field, and once it gets past Cordero, that's going to allow the run to score and Brito to go all the way to third. It's an RBI triple. The relay thrown away by Jeter Downs, but backed up. Scranton's got a 4-0 lead in the last inning. What a day for Socrates Brito. Five hits and a twin bill.
Reaching base in six straight plate appearances, Josh. Yeah, Cordero did all he could here. This was hit so hard. Look how far he had to go. You know, I think initially, if you're watching that from the stands, you thought that he misplayed that. He didn't. It was just hit so far away from him and so hard. And that's a huge run.
And now on the cusp of adding another with only one out, the infield has to come in. Ryan Lamar will be the hitter. Swinging through a pitch well outside the strike zone. Lamar 1-for-3 in this game.
Well, Ryan thinking fastball maybe. He sold out on that swing.
It's always inviting to hit with the infielders all the way in. There's another one to the backstop. That's going to be wild pitch number four in the game for Worcester, and the second one that brings in a run. That time from Austin Brice, Brito makes it 5-0. They've hit four batters, and now they've thrown four wild pitches in this game.
And Brito scored twice on wild pitches, plus a wild pitch in the fifth, helped create a run. No chance there for Pareda.
Kind of a sloppy game.
See a lot of game twos of doubleheaders like this at times.
Lamar went around on that one, 1-2. And now you know with these two extra runs, then the issue not nearly as much in doubt as it would have been otherwise. Does that change the calculus for Doug Davis as to whether or not Sean Boyle continues to try to finish a no-hitter? We shall see. Brice had only permitted three runs here with the Woo Sox all season before this inning. Three runs in 21 innings. And now he gives up two. Two and two on Lamar. And again he chased the slider. Strike three. Two out in the inning. That pitch was really bothering Lamar. He just couldn't pick it up.
Yep. Kept chasing him. Well, Josh, just looking in their bullpen, does not look like anyone's throwing.
One more look at the swing by Lamar.
He could not handle that pitch.
2 out, bases clear, 2 in. Armando Alvarez, cleanup batter in the box. Swinging through, piping hot fastball from Bryce.
Oh, a strikeout here, and all three pitchers for Worcester would have 4 strikeouts.
The fourth time in 2 months, that Worcester and Scranton have played a doubleheader here at Polar Park. Each of the first 3 times, it was split. And if this holds, make that true for a fourth. Out of play, nothing at 2.
Now you can see how Bryce is tough. He's got that slider. You have to have that in the back of your mind, but throws 94 to 95 with a low arm slot.
Well, Scranton's pitcher, Sean Boyle, may very well be going back out to the hill to try to finish a no-hitter, and it looks like, Mike, he's going to have to do it in some rain. It just started to mist for the first time in about 4, maybe 4.5 hours. 1-2.
It was raining a bit right when we started game one. And then it stops. That kind of rain. Annoying rain. Not for us, though.
Nice and dry up here, but we've had all sorts of rain. We've had hard rain, torrential rain, annoying rain, sideways rain. Broken bat, it sounded like. The play on a hop there for Rivera. Had to stay with it. That ball had some weird spin. Jeremy does to end the inning. Well, the Rail Riders score twice. So the lead is 5, and it's going to be Boyle, we think, going out to try to finish a no-hitter here at Polar Park. With the raindrops falling, Sean Boyle indeed on the hill, 78 pitches into an outing with no runs nor hits allowed through the first 6. A guy who had not gone longer than 4 1/3 innings in any of his low A, high A or triple A appearances prior to tonight. He's going to try to get through 7 and make it one of the memorable nights of his young career. Well, I guess it's already been that.
Yeah.
And now he can make it epic.
And you know he knows. It's amazing how these guys can bottle that in.
Franchi Cordero, Joey Meneses, Connor Wong are the 3 batters due up for the Worcester Red Sox here, trailing by 5. Cordero, one of 2 men to reach. Takes ball 1. Walked in the first, struck out in the 4th. Two and 0. Can you imagine that the leash is very short for Sean Boyle now as he approaches 80 pitches? He's just hit it. Good pitch. Soft contact, foul ball, 2-1.
Yep, Nelson is back up. It's a 2-0 pitch right in on the hands. Here's Nelson.
Cordero in his first day back from the big leagues. Takes ball 3. We remind you, this is the first ever start in a AAA baseball game for Sean Boyle. Made 2 relief appearances prior to tonight. Called a strike, it's full count.
That's a really good pitch. We've said that a lot tonight. It's a fastball. He throws this not too much.
I'm going to talk about a perfect 3-1 pitch with a no-hitter going. So now he'll have to do it 3-2. Went into the Woo Sox dugout area.
I wonder if he would come out even if he got Cordero out.
Oh, it's interesting. Are they just going to keep him going until he gives up a hit? He went around strike 3. 2 outs away from a no-hitter. Cordero chased ball 4.
Got to keep him in. Big pitch, 3-2. Cordero earned a walk in the first. This time, no. Look at that bat. It went through the zone. We'll get a better look here. Yep. Almost lost the grip. We've seen that a lot, Josh. Hitters losing the grip tonight. That means they're fooled.
Joey Meneses has grounded out and flown outs. Takes strike one outside corner right at the knees. He's pumped him in all night. Really showing no signs of fatigue.
No.
Now that was a generous strike granted. I don't blame Meneses for being upset about it. Cody Oates, the umpire, may have expanded the strike zone for a rare time.
Yep. McDowell caught it on the outer half. And Meneses is saying, give me a break. I know he has a no-hitter.
The pitch was outside. 1-2. In the major leagues, a 7-inning no-hitter does not officially count in the record books. The minor leagues, it does. 2-2. Blue Sox were within two outs of being no-hit earlier this year in Lehigh Valley. Michael Chavis broke it up in the ninth inning with a single. Two outs away here tonight. 2-2. On the ground, back through the middle. It's a play for the shortstop holder. Two out.
Well, different runner there, and I think it's an infield hit. Good play by Holder, just not hit hard enough. Look where Holder is, too. He had to go a long ways up the middle, Josh, to get that.
You know, and it hitting the mound changed the direction of the ground ball. Not only did it slow it down, but it knocked it closer to Holder to be able to make the out 6-3. Last hope, Blue Sox, Connor Wong. Well, Wong's been the best hitter all week for Worcester. In this game, he's flown to left and grounded to third. Seven hits over the first three games he played in the series. One out from history. 2-0. And Boyle has now gone two full innings longer than any of his previous appearances in 2021.
Guy that started the year at low A Tampa.
Big swing by Wong. 2-1 the count. Not leaving anything up, right out over the plate. Kept that one up and a bit away. Ninety-fourth pitch of the outing. 2-2, he's a strike away.
Well, I think he goes to his best pitch, and it's been that slider. Well, really, everything's been good tonight from Boyle. This is something.
A 24-year-old former 25th round pick. Never pitched at AA. They sent him right up from A-ball to help this AAA Scranton pitching staff. This is his first ever AAA start. In the air, shallow into right field. Brito coming on. It is history at Polar Park. 7-inning no-hitter. He'd never started a game above A-ball prior to 2 hours ago, and now he's put up a no-no here in the Canal District.
Unbelievable, Josh. And worth the celebration by his teammates. That was something. He was locked in from inning one. And we thought maybe the first ever no-hitter in Polar Park history would be for the Woo Sox, but a credit to Sean Boyle. What a job.
There were only two men that reached base in the outing. Franchi Cordero walked with two outs in the first. Jeremy Rivera hit by a pitch, one out of the sixth. And then this one off the bat of Connor Wong, Mike. The end of it for Sean Boyle.
And then the water. The water celebration. What a year for that kid. Starting at low A Tampa, going to Hudson Valley, skipping double A, and dominating here tonight.
He has now pitched 11 scoreless innings against Worcester. Made a relief appearance in the same game that Chris Sale pitched in Scranton a couple of weekends ago. This guy may never pitch a double A.
I don't think so. That was quite the performance. I don't think he threw a pitch harder than 91 all night, but it's not about that. Good sinker, good slider. I think his delivery, he had these guys timing off all night. We saw a lot of weird swings. He'll have a hard time sleeping right away tonight.
And I know it's only seven innings, but it's still rare to see one pitcher, the starting pitcher, go the full seven to complete a no-no, and that is a feat certainly worth celebrating for young Sean Boyle. Who'd have thunk it?
I think it's a great point. We don't usually see that. We don't see in the big leagues anymore. Guys finish games. We've seen no-hit bids in the big leagues that have been combined now.
Talking to the reporters here to recap what was a memorable night for Sean Boyle. And I would anecdotally add, I have to get this story in because this is a big moment in my life. The first ever baseball game I ever attended. Went with my father and my brother to a Phillies game. I grew up in Philadelphia. We went August 20th, 1990, saw the Phillies play the San Francisco Giants, and Terry Mulholland pitched a nine-inning no-hitter.
So August 20th?
Yes.
That's wow.
How about that?
Yeah.
That was 1990. So now here we are, August 19th in 2021. I have been to literally thousands of baseball games since. I had never seen another no-hitter until tonight.
And did you want to see another one at all, even if it was for the team you're calling, or did you just want that one that you saw as a fan?
Kind of felt like it was a cool little streak I had
going.
Yeah,
you did. Yeah. That's a good story.
Sean Boyle is the one that brings that to an end. So the Rail Riders and WooSox split this doubleheader, but it's Scranton and their right-hander Boyle that steals the headlines. But we've still got three games to come here in this series, and Mike, back to just regular old 1-9-inning game evenings. Coming up tomorrow, 6:30, we'll be back here on NESN Plus. Cutter Crawford is on the mound for Worcester, and there's a lot to live up to after tonight's doubleheader had so much intrigue. We look forward to seeing what the weekend has in store.
Certainly do.
Three Wildlife is coming up next here on NESN Plus. We certainly hope you'll keep it here for that. And thanks for being with us. Keith Folk got to watch a no-hitter. WooSox win the opener by a final of 5-3, but in a 5-0 win, Scranton gets a 7-inning no-hitter in his first ever AAA start from Sean Boyle. For Mike Antonellis, director Mike DeMars, producer Dylan McCaffrey, and our entire crew, we thank you so much for being with us for a long night of baseball from the Canal District. No-no in Worcester, 5-0 Rail Riders. Congratulations to Sean Boyle.